I visited Roderich in Dresden 2.5 years ago, actually, a while now, and heard him talking about some spin ice models. And basically, he was trying to argue that in the quantum limit, there will be some interest in physics. And I said, no, it can't be because of the Dephasing. And so this is how it started. And then I discovered that my old friend and collaborator Mark Dykman with his collaborator Vadim Smelyanskiy were working on something similar, and so we joined the forces, and so this is how this project started. Anyway, so what I'm going to talk about is basically particle wave dualism, but in a strongly correlated systems. So well, we know that wave is a particle in quantum mechanics. And then you can also, when you think about many-body interacting systems, there are a lot of situations where you can think about some, you can change variables in the many-body system and think about these objects like the main wall or sort of vertices or other sort of big fluffy objects in quantum mechanics, and you can think of them as particles. Now, when you do just usual change of variables in quantum mechanics, this is, you know, well known. But now, sort of, suppose you add the environment. And now this talk is about whether or not environment cares about your variables. Okay. And so I will do very, very simple model. I will concentrate on a simple topological defect, and for those in the audience who don't know what it is, I will explain what it is. So, well, this is a chemical molecule which is called polyacetylene, and so it's a row of single and double bonds, but once in a while you have a soliton where two double bonds come together. And you see what happens when one of those bonds switches to the right. This is, and each bond represents an electron. And so this is how conduction, electric conduction, happens in these conductive polymers. And so this object is called a soliton, and actually it carries a charge 1/2, so this is also an example of fractionalized charge system. Okay, so another example is very simple, and this is the example which I will sort of be referring to all the time. So I have spins which point to the left on the right, and spins that point up to the left, and spins that point down to the right, and so in between I have this domain wall. And so if I take this red spin and flip it, then you see the domain wall moves by one side. And so again, this is an example of a many-body defect, which is the domain wall, and for all practical purposes, you can write a Hamiltonian for this object, and it will be exactly the same Hamiltonian where sort of important variable is the position of the domain wall, and the Hamiltonian will be exactly as a Hamiltonian for a particle hopping on a chain. So this is called tight binding model. And another is soliton and spinless Hubbert model. So you have this brown dots by some reason. Anyway, so you have these brown dots, okay, which don't like to sit next to each other, so there is a next nearest neighbor repulsion. And so normally near half filling, you have every other side occupied. But once in a while, you have a couple of these dots again sitting together. And so again, this is transport. The particle hops to the right, and so this is how transport occurs. And so now the environment that we'll add, the environment is called Dephasing. And so in the case of a particle, so now I'm writing the density matrix, right? So the density matrix is a matrix. On the left-hand side and on the right-hand side are two different quantum states. And so here is just one matrix element of this density matrix, where on the left particle, this is a single particle, so particle sits in the third position, on the right particle sits on the fifth position. And so if you think quantum mechanically, or if you think locally, like whenever this, you know, the string changed only in two positions. So no matter how far from each other these positions are, the local environment knows there is a local change in two positions only. And so, as I will explain you sort of later on, okay, the dephasing rate for sort of this object for a particle will be exactly the same no matter how far left and right positions of the particle are. Okay, so whereas in the case of the domain wall, again, if I have here, I have the domain wall in the third position, here I have the domain wall in the, you know, three steps to the right, so this would be like in the sixth position, right? So there you see, in order to move it this far, I have to flip three spins. And so the further the domain wall moves, the more spins I have to flip. And again, as I will explain you later, locally, there is a lot of local change. And so the environment, each of those positions will see change configuration. And so the further of diagonal matrix element of the density matrix you consider, the faster this state will dephase. Okay, and so this is the same mechanism that makes the famous Schrödinger states unstable. So again, here you have a superposition of a bunch of spins up or a bunch of spins down, and then this state dephases, you know, much faster than a single spin. And of course, the cat, whether it's dead or alive, again, that dephases super fast. Okay, and so I will start by explaining how the dephasing works. And so we are looking at the density matrix evolution equation, where H, the Hamiltonian, involves some bath and some interaction. And for now, to derive the form of the dephasing Hamiltonian, I will just ignore the Hopin. I will set Hopin to zero. Okay. And so then, so you have some initial density matrix, which is rho of zero times, you know, product with the bath, the density matrix for the bath. And then you have evolution, Hamiltonian evolution on the left and on the right. And then to calculate the matrix element AB, you take, you know, AB, and then you have to trace out the bath degrees of freedom. Okay. And so now, as far as in the interaction representation, the environment will just add up. So interaction Hamiltonian is this F operator, which counts where the particle is. And then epsilon A is the energy, is the corresponding energy of the bath. So this is the operator. This is the operator in the variables of the bath. Okay. And so then you can do this calculation. You can, yeah. So then if you trace out the bath degrees of freedom, you go to in order to do that, you go into the interaction representation, and then all you will get are these exponential terms, and then you sort of manipulate, rotate under the trace, and so at the end you have this, using this trick of averaging, so you have e to the I phase, you approximate it by Gaussian, so you average it, so the average is zero in this case, and so it's just second cumulant in the exponent. So at the end, you get this famous Debye-Waller factor, which is, in this case, is the double integral of this, you know, functional WAB, which happens to be symmetric function. And then you can do some tricks, and then you discover, you know, again, integration here. And then you discover that the integral at large t, where t is large, which is t is large compared to the correlation, typical correlation time of the bath, you'll discover this linear decay of the phase. And again, it's very easy to explain. So if you have a bunch of, if you have a phase which is a sum of many random variables, right, the average of this operator, you'll get e to the negative phi squared. So this is phase diffusion. So the total square of the phase displacement is going to be proportional to t, and this is how you derive phase diffusion. So now, if you to make it work, it's not enough to just have phonon or boson emission and creation. You have to have phonon scattering. So in that case, this is a very robust effect, which is everywhere. So anybody who worked with two-level systems knows this, this. There is a standard decoherence model, which includes dephasing, you know, T1 and T2 times, and the dephasing is T2. So this is the standard, you know, one of the standard models of decoherence. Okay. So moreover, to sort of simplify it, to simplify the situation, I'm going to talk about the Markovian limit, where the correlation time of the bath is short compared to the energies that are relevant in the system. And so in the case of a particle, so the particle hops, so the red dot is a particle, so it hops to the right, to the right, to the right. And so as I argued, the dephasing rate for the MM prime matrix element of the density matrix is going to be independent of position. So no matter where you are, as long as you are away from the diagonal, you will get the density matrix, matrix elements decaying with the same rate. And I denote this rate gamma. Now, in the case of the domain wall, the same calculation, assuming the baths are independent at different position, the same calculation gives you the dephasing rate, which increases linearly with the distance to the diagonal. So you see this model, this is sort of ultimate quantum limit where the classical part of the density matrix, which is the diagonal part, evolves exactly the same. Moreover, first diagonal, you know, above the diagonal and below the diagonal, the first two diagonals, also the dephase is exactly the same because this quantity is equal exactly gamma. And so it is only far of diagonal matrix element where the evolution sort of is non-trivially different between the two systems. Okay, and question is there physics which is sensitive to this difference? So this is basically the purpose of my talk. Okay, and so the now that I derived the form of this dephasing operator, I'm going to add the hopping, and so combine the two. So this is just a simple evolution equation. So this is a system of linear equations that describes this density matrix evolution. So the hopping Hamiltonian is this two diagonal Hamiltonian. And then, yeah, let me see, there is the current that corresponds to the hopping, which is antisymmetric operator. And anyway, so what I do, I just sort of take matrix elements. So if I take matrix element from A to A, right, then the commutator with this hopping matrix element gives me rho minus a, rho a plus, you know, rho a minus 1, rho a plus 1. This is when I multiply from the left. Then if I multiply h on the right, I get these two terms. And then for the diagonal matrix element, there is no dephasing, so this is exact. Okay. And so what, you know, what this is for is basically what I'm saying is that the time derivative of the density at position A, right, is given by the difference for the current. So the red part is current on the right and left car part is current on the left, right? So this is the difference between currents that escape to the right and come from the left. Okay, so this is the, okay. And then if I take the first, oops, when I take the first of the diagonal matrix element, I will get some second diagonal contributions, but I also get this difference between two neighboring sites. And then now I will also get the dephasing term, which is now present. Okay. The point I want to make is the following. So you can continue this, and you will always get high derivatives. So for equation which corresponds to a plus two, a plus second components, you will get high derivatives, high differences of these quantities of the diagonal density matrix. And the statement is this, that as long as your density has a linear gradient, right? So along the diagonal, you apply a linear gradient. The exact solution of this density matrix equation is three diagonal. So the second, third, etc. diagonals are exactly zero. And that means there is, you know, when you are looking at transport, so you apply electric field and you try to see how the particle moves through the system, or you apply a different magnetic field to move this, the main walls, and you see in how the main wall moves through the system. So quantum mechanically, that motion is identical. Okay, and this is sort of, you know, so you get current proportional to density gradient as diffusion, and you have identical transport. Okay, now you can also take k to be finite, so linear gradient that corresponds to zero k, right? But and k is the momentum, so you can, so this density matrix evolution equation, Hopping-Hamiltonian, is the symmetry of this, so if both A and B, you move by one side, by two sides, etc., so whenever you move them together, the equation doesn't change. So there is no translation with respect to the difference coordinate, but there is a translational symmetry with respect to the common A and B coordinate. And so you can take the Fourier transform with respect to that coordinate. And then you introduce this additional phase, which helps to make the equation simpler. And so this is just the Fourier transform, okay? And then in these new variables, the equation that you get is the imaginary, so, you know, so this is the time derivative, this is like a Hopping term, and this is like a potential. So this is a Schrodinger's equation, a one-dimensional Schrodinger's equation with imaginary potential. So the Dephasing works as imaginary potential. Okay, then you can also do Laplace transform, and then you get the difference equation. So this is a linear second-order difference equation, and what it means is the following, that if you set right-hand side equal to zero, right, you see you can, if you know S minus one and S, you know psi S plus one. So there are exactly two linearly independent solutions for this difference equation. So, you know, no matter how far you go, if you know the wave function in two nearby positions, you will know it everywhere, right? And so if you choose your values to be 1, 0, and 0, 1, that will give you two linearly independent solutions. And so this solution, just like usual second-order differential equations, has two linearly independent solutions. It was, you know, I'm explaining so carefully because this was news to me. But anyway, so in the case of the particle, right, in the case of the particle, this quantity is, so the gamma, the potential, is constant everywhere, and then it's zero at some point. And so away from zero, you have the potential is a constant, right? And then this is equation is translational invariant, and so you can solve it by this substitution. So where y is the solution of this quadratic equation. Now, in the case of the domain wall, you have this difference equation with the coefficients that depend linearly with positions, okay? And, okay, now the story that I, you know, tell, my favorite book, of course, is Quantum Mechanics by Landau-Lifschitz. So it has an appendix. And the appendix, you know, that was before, the book was written before all of those textbooks about special functions were invented. And so Landau and Lifschitz thought it's important to add sort of, you know, how do you derive Bessel functions, how do you derive Hermite polynomial, et cetera. And it turns out there is a trick. You can solve all of these equations of the mathematical physics by a single trick. If you know how to solve second order differential equations with coefficients that change linearly with parameters. And so now this is a difference equation, but it turns out the same trick works. And so if you apply, you get Sommerfeld integrals for the imaginary argument Bessel functions. And sort of, you know, of course I knew because I taught so many times this in physics classes. So this is, you know, so we immediately saw this. And so anyway, so this is the general solution. So you see S is the index of the imaginary argument Bessel functions. Okay, anyway, And so basically what we have, and then you can, once you have these solutions which are true everywhere in this sort of, you know, then you can just glue them together. You can pick the coefficients, so you have the functions that decay rapidly at infinity. So you can sort of glue them together at the origin, and then you get full solutions for these problems. And so what I plotted, so these are these solutions written explicitly. And so what I plot, you know, you see this functionally, they look very different. Here you have some power loss. Here you have imaginary argument Bessel functions. But what turns out that when gamma, the Dephasing is small compared to the bandwidths, they look very, very similarly. Okay. And then, moreover, this quantity is called the structure function, and this is something that you can measure, for example, in neutron scattering. So one of these objects that I didn't have a picture for, there are the main walls in the antiferromagnets, and in neutron scattering physics, these are well-known objects because they are accessible in neutron scattering experiment, and these are called Villain modes. Okay. But anyway, and so there is one difference, you know, the form factor. So psi zero is actually this the structure factor. In the case of the domain wall, you also get this geometrical factor, because when, you know, if the new domain wall is here, you sort of sum over the positions of the spins to the left and to the right, so you have interference from all of those positions, and that gives you an additional factor in the denominator. But anyway, but except for this sort of purely trivial factor, the traces, what I'm saying, the spectral functions look very much similarly. And then you can do real-time evolution. And so the Fourier transform of that quantity would be the displacement probability. So you start at zero at the origin, and then you say, what is the probability for a particle sometime t later, so this is t, to be either at the same position, or at position one, or at position three, at two, et cetera. So each of these curves is the time dependence of the probability to find the particle at, you know, at the origin, at position one, and position two, et cetera, as a function of time. So if you don't have the Dephasing, then these are proportional to the real argument Bessel functions. And so this is, you cannot see it probably. There is a tiny little line, which is black thin line, okay, which corresponds to the part, to that case. But then the red line is the particle, the blue line is the wave, and you see they look almost identical. And now if I increase the Dephasing, both of them still sit more or less on top of each other. They start to deviate from the case of the particle. And if I increase Dephasing even more, they still sit very much on top of each other. So, of course, there are tiny quantitative differences, but it would be very hard to convince any experimentalist to measure those, because qualitatively these curves look very much the same, and they differ quite a lot from the case of the particle. Okay. And my basic message here is that this this is the second experiment, right? So first, you know, where you don't see much of a difference between the case of the domain wall and the particle. And this is not surprising because, as I said from the beginning, the evolution differs in a sort of substantially quantum matter. Right, so the diagonal part of the density evolution, first of the diagonal set of the matrix elements, they all evolve exactly the same way. It is just the far of the diagonal matrix elements that evolve differently. And the statement is, in the usual transport setting, if you have a big infinite system and try to measure some transport properties, that is very insensitive to this kind of quantum physics. Even though the process is called quantum diffusion, the process that I described is called quantum diffusion. Okay. Anyway, so the thing where we hope to see a difference is the situation where you form a bound state. So you see what you sort of, you know, now I imagine having just a finite chain, and so the way the bound state forms is the wave propagates along the chain, right? And then it gets reflected, and then it interferes with itself constructively. And so you have to have this constructive interference after one cycle of reflections, so that you get from wave propagating to the right, reflect, you get another wave that propagates to the right. And so as long as you have this constructive interference, you will have a bound state. And of course, in order to have this interference, obviously, you have to have the matrix cell, you know, you have to have the density, if you think about it in terms of the density matrix, this is the difference by the entire length of the chain. So this is exactly the kind of physics that we hoped for to distinguish between these two cases. Okay. Mm. And moreover, the longer the chain length, you should see a dramatic increase in the difference. Okay. And so now what we are going to measure is the AC linear response. So in the case of the particle, we're going to shake the domain, this entire system a little bit. So we're going to apply electric field, which is time dependent, sinusoidal electric field along the chain. And that would excite some oscillations in the system, and then the response would be what is the current time-dependent current induced in the system. So in the case where the frequency matches one of the resonances, you're supposed to see a sharp peak. Okay. Now, this is true in the case of the quantum system, but then let us think what happens if you add the dephasing. So dephasing, right? So what the dephasing does is the coupling to the bath, right? Where the bath sort of is sensitive, you know, you don't cause really transitions in the bath, but you change the phase of the wave function, but some quantity that depends on the bath state. And so the phase, how the phase evolves linearly with time, that's energy. And so when you have an ability to change sort of, you know, by some small amounts over, but over time the changes will accumulate, when you change the randomly this phase, you will get energy non-conservation. So the statement is with dephasing, energy is not conserved. And moreover, if you have this delta correlated dephasing, the Hamiltonian that I wrote, this corresponds to, formally, it corresponds to infinite temperature. And so if you try to find the stationary solution of that equation, the only stationary solution corresponds to fully mixed state, which is the density matrix element, which is diagonal and proportional to identity matrix. And basically, this approximation is a little too crude to capture the finite states. So one way you can do it, you can rederive the equations, and you know we know how to do it at finite temperature. You can get Einstein equation to get the mobility, or what I'm doing for the purpose of this talk, I'm just going to postulate the equilibrium density matrix, which is just proportional to the Hamiltonian. And then I will use linear response, assuming that the temperature is much, much bigger than the bandwidth. So the temperature is the biggest quantity in this case. And the bandwidth is then big compared to the gamma. And so the evolution density matrix evolution equation, so I just expand to linear order in the perturbation Hamiltonian, and the perturbation Hamiltonian is exactly what I told you it is. So you have this cosine, the harmonic term, and then the usual sort of what this is just a linear potential in the second quantized notation, okay? So you have time-dependent potential, E0 is a small perturbation, and then delta rho is the perturbation to the density matrix. And so this equation is, again, linear equation. And so now, this is now becomes a more complicated problem. And so how do you solve it? For small gamma, you can use degenerate perturbation theory. So the H, the Hamiltonian in this case, so the approximation is that gamma is much smaller compared to the bandwidths, right? And so when gamma is extremely small, then you should solve this equation in the eigenstate basis. And so if for the matrix element between states M and M, this commutator will be EM minus EN. And then you add I omega, because this is the evolution of the everything. And so it is this difference that has to be small, right, that correspond to the resonances. Okay. And now, sort of, for a chain, the solutions are sinusoidal. So this picture, so this is position one, position L, and the chain solutions are sine of whatever, sine of kx, in this, you know, where k is quantized. And then the energy levels are proportional to the cosine of k. And so you see there is this negative, you know, cosine of k. So this label is now the m equal 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So there are exactly six energy levels in this case. And so what this picture is for is the following. So you see, whenever you have a transition between state m and n, there is a symmetric transition between state M prime and N prime on the other side of the chain that have exactly the same energies. Okay. And so when you are solving these equations, if you are looking at some different transition, the energy difference will be different. And so at small gamma, you can drop all of those different transitions, but only keep these two transitions and use and sort of write the degenerate perturbation theory to solve this equation. Okay. Now, this matrix element, it turns out, it is only non-zero. This is the driving current. Symmetry of the wave functions is such that the matrix element is only non-zero when this M minus N is odd. So this is an allowed transition. Transitions from first to third state is not allowed because the difference is even. And then from one to three, it's again allowed because the difference is odd. Okay. Anyway, so how do you do this degenerate perturbation theory? You know, just as I said, you just say there are only two matrix elements of the density matrix that participate. And so you can call one of them psi zero, and then there is this sort of, this is the corresponding pair of states, and then psi one is the other coordinate, and then you take matrix element of this equation between states A, B, and A prime, B prime, and so you get this 2 by 2 matrix evolution equation, where by construction, this resonant term is identical, and then you have this contribution, which is the density matrix contribution from the Dephasing, and then the matrix elements from the current. And so by symmetry, these two matrix elements are identical. Gamma 0, 0, gamma 1, 1 are identical. 1, 0, gamma 0, 1, and gamma 0, 1 are also identical. And so if you add this equation together, you can write a simple equation for just the sum of the wave functions. And so you get Lorentzian resonances with this width. Okay. And then you can calculate these matrix elements explicitly. And so in the case of the particle, the answer actually is L minus 1 over L plus 1 times gamma. So as I said, it is nearly independent of the length of the chain, right? Whereas for the domain wall, the answer is gamma times something that multiplies L. So I actually, the paper is not out yet because I was missing these solutions, and so I actually derived them this morning. So gamma 0, 0 happens to be proportional to L, and you see it's sine squared times this gamma. Okay, so this is a positive quantity, and there is a contribution from far off diagonal matrix elements, and so if you think about it, it's like the volume of a solid. So it's proportional to height. And so the bigger the height, the bigger the volume. And so indeed you get something that is linear, whereas gamma 0, 1 happens to be negative, but it's proportional to 1 over L. So the contribution basically disappears. Okay, anyway, The answer is that indeed, in this approximation, in the approximation that gamma is very, very tiny, you get the line width, which is proportional to the length of the chain for the domain wall, and which remains constant in the case of the particle. Okay, so you can also solve the same equations numerically. And so this is the case of the chain with length equals 5, with very, very tiny, okay, it says 5, 7, trust this because this was generated by the program. Okay, so this is length equals 7, so temperature is high, and you see that at this small Dephasing rate, you see sharp peaks, and the blue is the domain wall, red is the particle. And so this is transition 1, 2, this is 2, 3, this is 3, 4. The transitions from 1 to 3 is forbidden, and then these are odd, okay, so 1 to 3, 2 to 4, this is where you would expect to see those transitions, but they are not here, there is no peak at all. And then 1, 4 to 5, there are a couple peaks that are sharper in the case of the particle and sort of small in the case of the domain wall. Okay. And now if I increase the Dephasing just a little bit, you see in the case of the particle, you still can resolve the peaks very well, whereas in the case of the domain wall, they started to collapse. And then once more, domain wall, you just see this big blob, and you can still distinguish some peaks in the case of the particle. Okay, so if you increase the lengths, you, in order to see any peaks, you have also to decrease the Dephasing a lot, because you remember that the difference between the peaks is proportional to 1 over L. Okay, and so in this case, if I increase gamma by a factor of 5, for the domain wall, these peaks started to disappear, whereas for the particle, they are still here. So this is gamma, another factor of 5 bigger. You can still see, well, some peaks in the case of the particle and no peaks in the case of the domain wall. Okay. And so, this is some attempt of doing analytic calculation, which actually failed anyway. And so this basically takes me to the conclusions, okay. And the conclusion is that quantum Dephasing happens when quantum diffusion happens, this is the process that I described, happens when Dephasing is faster than relaxation of the energy, right? So when T1 is much, much bigger than T2, this, okay. Now, if you have a topological defect, the one whose motion changes the background configuration of the system, right? The far off diagonal matrix elements of the density matrix dephase much, much faster than the elements, matrix elements, which are close to the diagonal. Now, if you try to do an experiment in the infinite system, it's very hard to see the difference. The two cases that I considered, linear transport, which is the process called quantum diffusion, as well as the spectral function or real-time response, you know, probability to move some distance, they look almost identical. On the other hand, if you look at the spectrum of the bound states in the two systems, you discover that the width scales, the width goes, you know, the width of the peak grows much faster with the grows much faster in the case of the domain wall, and so this is this manifestation of the physics that we're after. Now, sort of, this kind of physics is ubiquitous in quantum mechanics. So there are spin chain materials, there are solitons and conducting polymers, there are the quantum crystals where people studied dislocation glide. So all of those processes people sort of studied, and the transport, you know, this is the situation where linear transport was studied, and it actually sort of quantum mechanical in nature. So this is the quantum diffusion process. On the other hand, the prediction is that if you form a small system and are able to do spectroscopy, then you should see a dramatic difference between these two systems. And then sort of it turns out that this is possible to do now in the optical traps. So you can have a trap which is nearly rectangular. And so you can have, in effect, a finite length nearest neighbor Hubbard, spinless Hubbard model, which you can load with sort of, you know, with the right number of particles, and then you can do spectroscopy there, and hopefully, can, you know, this would be another experimental confirmation of this. Anyway, so this is what I wanted to say. So, okay, thank you.